declares that whether we live or die, if we know the Lord, we live our life in the Lord, and when we die, we are still in the Lord. So therefore, we have that comfort that Diane is with the Lord. And this afternoon, we've gathered to celebrate her life, the life that she lived here on earth with us, the love that you shared with her, the common interests and joys that you shared with her. And as we head into this celebration, I have a not quite so celebratory announcement to make. The ladies' restroom just backed up, and so I apologize for that. Right outside this door, right behind this wall, there is another restroom, a handicap restroom, that we ask that the ladies would all use that one, please. And I apologize for that. Let's pray. Holy God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather and celebrate Diane's life. We thank you for the years that we had with her and for the love that was shared. And I pray for your comfort and strength for those who cared for her, or her family especially, and that, Lord, you would just bless them with many fond remembrances, times of laughter and love shared, and that those would come at the times that they needed most. For all who loved her, Lord, friends and family alike, enfold them in your care, comfort them with your presence, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Come to me, all of you about to share is something that was read to us, and you may find it familiar. It was read to Uncle Tom and Ryan, my mom and I, when we were sharing time with Annie Diane at hospice. And Uncle Tom found it especially comforting, so I thought you might enjoy it here today. Death is nothing at all. I've only slipped away to the next room. I'm still I, and you still you. Whatever we were to each other, that we are still. Call me by my old familiar name and speak to me in the easy way you always have. Put no difference in your tone. Wear no forced air of solemnity or sorrow. Laugh as we always laughed at the little jokes we always enjoyed together. Play, smile, think of me, and pray for me. Let my name always be the household word that it always was. Let it be spoken without effort, without the ghost of a shadow in it. Life means all that it was. There is absolute, unbroken continuity. Why ever should I be out of your mind? Because I am out of your sight. I am waiting for you so very near, somewhere near, just around the corner. All is well, and nothing has passed. Nothing is lost. One brief moment, and all will be just as it once was.
Oh. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is the word of God.
Where did Diane come from? Do you realize that her and I lived 2.5 blocks from one another? And we didn't meet later until I was 23 and she was 29. And, wow. I ever asked her if she knew the Guggenlos down the street. She said she thought they were juvenile delinquents. I said, no, that was my brother Dan. She, at that time, was working at the bank. And I had my first teaching job in Rainier, and I was a coach. And we met at the American Legion, because that's where everybody went to dance. And so we had a dance, and I got her phone number, and we just decided 7 months later that we were going to get married. Went to the house and told my parents, and my dad said I was crazy. She's got 3 kids. But I told him I didn't listen to him anymore, so. And then actually, her brother Dave called and said, Tom, there's a job open up at Lakes High School. So I thought, you know, that would be a pretty good deal. We decided we'd like to move out of the hometown and get up to Clover Park, and so I got the job. And so we rented for a while, and then she took me down into Oak Brook and said, I want to buy this house. I said, I got 3 kids, I got a wife, and now you want me to spend $29,000 and buy a house. So, but she had a vision, she always did. And so that kind of led to a little bit more of a family relationship between us, because a lot of things were happening. Kids were playing soccer, and we hung out with Dave and Linda, and they used to go to Lake Chelan, so we'd go to Lake Chelan. And she just, she really liked that family-oriented things that they did. And so then comes First Security Bank. She was a good teller. And so she'd been working at First Security, and she loved that bank. She was put all her heart into it. And Ollie, her boss, told her, you know, you're the best teller I have ever seen in 35 years. She never had a problem getting the job. So you know what that cost. She had new parents now. It's called Mr. and Mrs. Nordstrom. She definitely liked to dress up. She looked really good all the time when she'd go to work, and we spent a lot of time at Nordstrom's. Probably some of you guys could relate to that. And then, you know, I got into building, and I'm probably the only guy in Lakewood, or along a lot of guys, that built his wife 6 brand new houses. And you know, she loved to decorate, and she just—it was her idea, the first house, and then maybe mine, and then she had it. So every 4 years, we live in a new house. We never had to buy any new appliances. And her one thing that she did, though, she'd come into the house and she'd say, we have to, I don't like this and I don't like that. So I tried to explain to her that those walls do not have roller skates. But she usually won out, as probably some of you know her and have known her, that she pretty much is going to get her way. And we had a lot of great family Christmases, and she loved to entertain, she loved to decorate. And then this home that we purchased, we finally did buy that house, by the way. So then my neighbor got us going on Oak Brook Country Club. I said, country club, that's pretty high up for a guy from Kelso. But you know, it was just, she loved the entertaining over there. And quite frankly, Ryan had a job, and we always knew where he was going to be after school, because the pro called me. He was about like 8 or 10, so he was the ball boy, and he did that until I think he was close to graduating from college. So it was, she liked to dress up to go to the balls and to the musicals and the plays. And then during the summers, you know, being a teacher, so always trying to make extra money, I had a friend that I had a job down in Tacoma. And so one day she drove up in this convertible Mercedes, bright silver, not bright, but a nice clear coat silver, and a top down. And she called me over and she said, well, how do you like this? I says, well, you know, what is it? And how do you, what are you doing with it? She says, don't worry, I just bought it. So, you know, she never needed my permission to buy a car. It was going to be in the driveway when I got home. So then we decided that, you know, we would go to Lake Tahoe for a little vacation. We did that about 10, 12 years. And she just loved to go up to the Ponderosa and have breakfast, go out on the Lady of the Lake and have dinner. And she loved that Big Bertha, you know, that slot machine. And so we went there for about 14 years in a row. And always on the way there, we had to stop at about every antique store that was, you know, in the path of going to Tahoe. And she generated a love for dolls and met this new bunch of ladies, and they took her on that road to collecting dolls. And so that's kind of like how that happened. But in that process, she met a bunch of crazy doll nuts. I'll tell you, if you want to know what a googly doll is in a French fashion, you can just ask me. Because over the years, I've heard all those, and I loved the googly doll and had the little cross-eyed. And she bought one, and in those days, it was always buy and sell high, and I didn't want her to sell that little doll. I love that little doll. Then she met this lady named Yvonne Baird, who became one of her best friends, and then it became more dolls, and more dolls, and more dolls. And later, she couldn't go to a lot of the shows, so she sold on the internet. She got enjoyment out of that. And you can see she was a strong lady. She she always supported my golf.
Well, today I'm going to share my mom's thoughts, Linda Studebaker, who cherished her relationship with Diane from as long as certainly I can remember every conversation about my auntie. And unfortunately, she couldn't be here today since her sister is also fighting lung cancer. She had to go be with her in Texas. So she did, however, write a note, and I'll read it in my mom's words. Diane, my sister, my friend. I met Diane 52 years ago when we were both very young and I was getting to marry her brother Dave. I remember thinking, she looks just like Elizabeth Taylor. What a beautiful lady. So recently, Diane's been characterized as a private person. Well, I'm not sure about the private, but I am quite sure about strong-willed. I learned early on that an argument with my sister-in-law, Diane, was not one I would win, nor did I need to, because she was usually right. She was smart, she was gorgeous, and always on a mission in her waking hours. A collector extraordinaire, Diane dabbled in most anything collectible for short periods of time. When she was done, and then she was on to another hunt. Her longest-lived passion was, of course, her dolls and the myriad of accessories that came with them. But she also had some interesting eccentricities. Try getting Annie Diane on an airplane or an elevator. It never happened. We were lucky to have Tom and Diane and their family near us when our children were growing up. It seems like there was never a dull moment in their lives. Diane went to a garage sale one day, bought a house. Went home and told Tom they could just paint the house for a down payment. Move accomplished. Another time, she bought a Mercedes sports car and a diamond ring on her lunch hour. And if I remember correctly, it was the same day. I just shook my head and said, go girl. Diane and I rotated cooking on holidays. Everyone was happiest when the dinner was going to be at the Guglielmo's. Because She was a wonderful cook and a hostess. She made pie crust like nobody could make pie crust and was always on deck for dessert, no matter who was cooking. We did miss one holiday meal together when Tom and Diane were moving to yet another house. Of course, on Thanksgiving Day, we went to Kelso for dinner with Dave's parents and came home to learn that the Guglielmos had moved. And Diane had hung the pictures on the wall, went out and bought a turkey, and cooked Thanksgiving dinner for her family all that day. She did not let any grass grow under her feet, ever. Diane's passion, first and foremost, was always her husband Tom and her children. She was fiercely loyal and protective and ever giving of herself to make sure her family was comfortable and safe. She always made sure that their homes were beautifully decorated, and there was for many years a new home about every 5 years, although I'll make sure Mom knows she's been corrected, it was every 4. And oh, the fun she had making each one unique and special. We shared so much, Diane and I will miss our regular phone calls and our lunch dates when I was in town, our sharing of family secrets and joys and tragedy. We joined one fraternity to which no parent would ever aspire when we each lost a child. No one knew our sorrow like Diane and I knew each other's, but I have no doubt now that Robin and Jesus met Diane when she entered her very last house, and together they were watching over Tom, Scott, Brian, and the rest of us. Rest well, dear friend. I know you're redecorating as we speak.
Thank you for those beautiful memories. The family would like to give the rest of you an opportunity. If you wanted to share a story or a memory, these things mean a lot to the family. Perhaps we could have a hand mic and an usher could just hand that to you. All you need to do is stand up where you're at and they'll hand you a mic. Hold it close, otherwise it doesn't do any good. And just share. Give you a minute to think about it. Try to share the story without crying. But Diane had excellent taste, as all of her friends know. And I know Diane through the golf club. And we were at her house for a fabulous Christmas party. And everything she made the best, cheese soup, and it was this beer and cheese soup, and I begged her for the recipe and got it. And she served everything on the most exquisite Christmas dishes I had ever seen. And I loved those dishes. They were absolutely gorgeous. And I said to her, I said, Diane, wherever did you get these dishes? And she said, well, they were just a one-time thing. They only came out once. And I said, oh my gosh, if you ever decide that you wouldn't want them, you have to tell me first. Well, as luck would have it, Diane liked to change. We all know that, right? I never thought she would ever want to let go of those dishes, but she called me up, and it was during a time when I had 2 daughters in college. It was very hard to have extra money, and these dishes were very expensive. She sold them to me for a very little amount, and she said that the one condition was that you love eating with them with your family the way I loved sharing them with mine. And so the love from her family came to my house with those dishes.
Thank you.
In 1982, I was hired at First Security Bank by Diane. And in 1984, my fiancé and I were going to go to the courthouse to be married. Diane would not hear of it. She said, you're going to come to my home, then my backyard, and have your wedding. So 29 years ago, in July, I was married at Tom and Diane's beautiful home on Turquoise Drive. And her generosity and kindness and love will always be etched in my heart. I'll miss you.
There was another person.
Well, there's one thing that's being left out, and that's Diane's bridge plane. Mm-hmm. Now, Diane already lived in Pemberton Creek when I moved there, and we did a lot of things about how we were going to straighten everything out in that community, and as far as we're concerned, we did it. And anyway, then I don't know much about her life with the dolls, except that it was very important to her. But suddenly, she wanted to play bridge. Now, she didn't want to just sit there and fiddle-faddle around with cards. She wanted to know every bid she should make, every trick she should take, and get the score right. And she just kept getting better and better. But she always carried her bridge book instructions with her, right by her side every time. And she did turn out to be a good bridge player.
That's a wonderful story. Thank you for sharing that side, Diane. Up here for Jackie.
I was a bridge partner of Diane's for a few years. And I did a lot of shopping at Birdcrest Pharmacy, where we picked up lots of pills. Evidently, Diane shopped there too. But I was in there one day, and I saw Tom, and he was looking a little frustrated. I asked him what the problem was, and he said, I'm trying to find a Band-Aid. He said, Diane had had some surgery on her nose, and she wanted a Band-Aid that would match her skin. She didn't want anybody to notice she was wearing a Band-Aid. And the next time I played bridge with her, I asked her how things went, and she said, I don't know where he found it, but he matched my skin pretty well.
That's wonderful.
And I met Diane when a friend of mine brought me to a dog club meeting. And this wasn't the high class dog club meeting. This was like for people who got their dolls at the Goodwill and garage sales in different places. But she always entertained us and treated us just like we were the high class doll people. And we all loved her dearly.
Barbara Bullinger, and I was in that first collectible doll club, and then Diane introduced me to Tacoma Doll Club. I loved being around Diane. She was intelligent. I loved her voice. I thought her voice was just beautiful. She was always once, twice, three times a lady. If you define the word class, that was Diane, and her presence, and her manner, and her graciousness, and her beautiful entertaining. We all enjoyed that. And she did collect dolls, but not like some of us. I have some nice dolls, but Diane had the best. She only collected dolls that most of us couldn't afford. But like everyone said, she was ready to get rid of them, you know. She was one of the best people I ever knew at moving on. I'm going to miss her.
And she loved her animals.
just learned a new story about Diane from one of the doll club members who couldn't be here. And this is the story. I didn't know. Diane was always full of surprises. And I shouldn't be surprised, but I am. This friend of ours, and I won't give you her name because I haven't asked her permission to share the story. She was having a hard time one Christmas and happened to share that with Diane a couple of years ago. And Diane, all of a sudden, there was a package that arrived on her doorstep. And inside was a doll, and this doll person loves to sew. And there were patterns and things so that she could sew for this doll. So Diane, she says, I'm not going to be able to exchange gifts this year, this friend that lives in Washington here, because we're having rough times. And Diane supplied Christmas for her, so she had a doll at Christmas. So that's Diane. And I was lucky enough to have her. She had me for a secret pal. We have secret pals in our groups. And she gave me a wonderful book about Native American dolls and some scoops. You know what those are. They're kind of a blanket wrapped Native American doll, and I received several from Diane. So wonderful memories of her, and I will miss her too.
Say that those of us who were privileged enough to have Diane in our life were given a rare and beautiful gift.
I'm going to be brief and not too sentimental so that I can just share Diane's style, so to speak. I have attended probably over 50 doll club meetings and doll shows and other doll events with Diane throughout the years. And Diane would attend these functions, and then during the middle of the function or toward the end, we'd look around and we'd say, well, where's Diane? And without any to do, you know, Diane would have left, and somebody would say, oh, I think she just left. She wanted to get on the freeway before the traffic got too heavy. And this was just Diane's style, not to make a big to-do over anything, but just to do something that was important to her. And she just never involved people with any of her problems or anything along those lines. And she ended her life in pretty much the same way. Just nothing. Just no to-do about anything. Just, where's Diane? She's the model.
That's beautiful. Thank you. We have a video that the family has put together, and we're going to share that with you at this time.
Thank you. what's right from wrong. Always knowing all that you made us be tough, but never too rough. Rise above what you said, never easily loved. This is your song. We wrote it for you. You don't want to call it just a minute or two. You are our friend. Walked with you till the end. And one day. This is your song. So I'll try and go on, loving all that we know. Through the hardest of times, you put on a show. You made us stand tall.
Stay on now and forever.
It's always a precious time to see those family pictures and slides and remembrances. That was a beautiful closing on that. A few years ago, I officiated at a service for another woman who also collected dolls, so perhaps there will be a club when we all get up there with them. In closing, I want to share some words from the book of John, the 14th chapter. Jesus said these words to comfort his disciples. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. Jesus said these words because he was facing death, and he had shared this with his disciples, and he wanted to give them comfort that they would be with him when their time came also. Today, my prayer is that these words will comfort you, that your heart need not be troubled over Diane's death. Grieved, yes, but not troubled, because we know that the Lord came and took her to the eternal home that he had made for her. And as you have heard it speculated, she may already be redecorating that home. So as we close today, let's do so with joyful remembrances of her life, of her dolls, but most of all, of the love that she had for her family and for her friends and the many ways in which she expressed that. Let's pray. Holy God, we thank you for this time to remember Diane, for this special woman who graced so many lives, for the love that she shared with Tom, for their years together, we thank you, for her life with her children, with nieces, nephews, extended family, we thank you for those years, for her friendships, her love for dolls, bridge, her beloved dog, Teddy, both one and two. We thank you for those times together, and we pray that as we go forward in life, that you would give comfort and peace. Lord, you know her birthday is coming up, and we pray that even though that will be a sad time, that it will be a time remembering birthdays past, spent with love and joy, and that those times would bring comfort. We thank you for your ongoing faithfulness and for your surrounding us with peace and with the knowledge that we will be reunited one day. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We have another solo. Reception, which will be in Prairie Hall, out the double doors and back over in the next building. I will ask after the benediction that you remain seated until I dismiss you, giving the family time to get over to the reception area so that they might be there to greet you when you arrive. And that'll give you an opportunity then to visit with them, and we'll be moving the pictures over, and you'll have an opportunity to see those and to spend some time together. Share your stories and your memories with the family when you have an opportunity. I know not everyone can just stand up and speak into a microphone, so share those things with them this afternoon. And now as you go, go with the love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the comfort and the strength of the Holy Spirit. Amen.